and welcome to Passport to Pittsburgh Adventures. I'm your host, Kim Adley, and virtual tour guide for adventures around Pittsburgh and beyond. And today we are beyond. We are in Little Washington. For all you Western PA people who call Washington, PA, Little Washington, I know I grew up calling it that. We are here visiting a treasure. Part of our three-part series for the Whiskey Rebellion, we visited the Woodville Plantation and the Neville House, and our second stop here today is the David Bradford House in the heart of downtown Washington, PA. We're in for a treat to look back at the way things were during the time period of the Whiskey Rebellion, and I always tell you, we cannot know where we are unless we know where we came from. So let's take a little adventure. Welcome to Passport to Pittsburgh Adventures, and you know we're taking a journey back into history today, and I'm so happy to be here in this beautiful dining room of the David Bradford House in Washington, PA, and I have a wonderful guest with me today. She is the director of the David Bradford House and a friend,
yes,
Tracy Liberatore, and thank you so much for being with me today, Tracy.
Thank you so much for coming. It's so great to show you the house.
Oh, well, it's my first time here. I'm embarrassed to say, but it's so beautiful. And right here in the middle of Little Washington. That's what we always called it when we were growing up in Pittsburgh.
Everyone still calls it that.
Do they?
You're good.
Okay, wonderful. So how long have you been the director here at the David Bradford House?
So in February, it'll be 9 years.
Oh my goodness, wonderful. Are you drawn to history, or tell me what drew you to the position?
Well, honestly, I knew nothing about history before I started here, and my family was like, what are you getting yourself into? I have a strong business background. I was a project manager before coming here, and I had a friend on the board who reached out to me and said, we could use some help. What do you think? And a couple hours turned into a couple more hours, turned into a part-time position, turned into a full-time position, turned into event planning, and it's just, I kind of look at it like everything that we do here is a project. We have events, it's a project, we host tours, it's a project, but it's a lot of fun, and I have learned a ton of history.
That's wonderful. The house is very special. It's on the National Registry of Historic Places. And when you get that special recognition by the Department of the Interior, it means a few things for the property, doesn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
And what are some of the things that it indicates can't be changed, or how the building is preserved?
Correct. So we were originally owned by the Pittsburgh Historical Museum Commission, which got us the National Historic Landmark rating. Mm-hmm. So we now are owned by our association, so it's a volunteer group that owns the house. However, we still, as you said, go to their standards. So they come in every couple years and mm-hmm. they look at what is here and make sure that it still matches. There's two parts of the house. There's the historic part and then we have an addition. The historic part we leave as is. We're here to tell a story about history, so we're not going to come in and put something that doesn't fit to time, because believe me, you will have people who will come through the house and will question you.
Yes.
So
in other words, everything in the original part of the house, which was built in 1788,
correct,
has to stay the same.
Exactly.
And cannot be altered or changed architecturally or in decoration either.
You're absolutely right.
Well, that's good to know. So when we look, and I look at this room that we're in right now, I'm very surprised at the really vivid color.
Right. So that is one of the main things people say, but they are true to the period. You'll notice the bright, I call it peach in here. Another
yes.
room is green. We actually, the funny story is we had the house repainted in 2011, uh-huh. and we had the hardest time matching. Of everything we've done through restoration, the paint was the hardest thing to match.
You know,
but
Tracy,
it is true.
I don't think you're alone. Picking paint can be difficult for just about everybody.
You are right.
So at least you had some guidelines with history to help you make your choices. So the dining room is quite a bright room, and it looks like you're ready for Thanksgiving here.
Yeah, so we are actually always decorated like that. David, being a lawyer, he entertained here. So the house is set up as though he was entertaining.
So we want to learn more about David Bradford, and we're going to take a tour of the house, see some more of the wonderful rooms, and meet some of your wonderful docents here. So tell me, who was David Bradford?
David Bradford was a very wealthy attorney in this area.
So this is a pretty fancy house for the time period.
This is a very fancy house for the time period. Mm-hmm. The time this house was built, Washington was just a small hamlet here. It consisted of a gathering of basically log homes. People were still living in log cabins here, 16 by 16 log cabins. When David bought this property, the lot next door to it, he bought also, and it contained one of those 16 by 16 foot cabins, mm-hmm. which he converted into his office. Mm-hmm. But because his wife-to-be, they really did not care to live out on his farm near 84. She really wanted to live in town because of Indian raids. This area was still subject to Indian raids at the time. And to please her, I think, was a lot behind his decision to build this townhouse in town.
Well, some things in history haven't changed, have they?
No, they haven't.
People are still building houses to please their wives,
aren't they?
We're still trying to please them. Well, so he built this. It's quite an impressive stone mm-hmm. house.
Stone house.
Two-story.
Mm-hmm. Two and a half stories. Actually, yes. If you count the attic, which was a servant's quarters at the time.
So they had servants as well, which is probably also rare at that time in this area.
Yes and no. There were indentured servants that were fairly prolific with the tradesmen through here. There's no indication that David had actually indentured servants, but he did have servants. He did have slaves. There were still people that had slaves at this period.
Okay.
And they helped build the house, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. The walls were anywhere from 18 to 23 inches thick from stone that was quarried not too far away from here on the other side of Washington Cemetery.
And the stone is?
The stone is native sandstone.
Native sandstone.
Right.
It's quite an impressive building.
The reason this house is still standing after 300 and some years.
It looks really strong. Mm-hmm. So we are in the parlor of the house, mm-hmm. and you can see that he has his desk in here, mm-hmm. and it's quite a charming room, and the color, again, also surprises me.
The David Bradford House, over its 300-plus year history, has had a dozen owners at least. The first one was Archibald Kerr and his family. The house was difficult to sell because the cookhouse out back burned down. And in fact, it wasn't sold. David had left here in 1794. It wasn't until 1805 before the house was actually sold to another owner.
Empty for a while.
It had been rented.
Rented.
Yes, they had been renting it. And while it was being rented was when the first cookhouse burned down. So it's difficult to sell a house without a kitchen. The Kerr family did buy it in 1803, and built a cookhouse, and it burned down. So that's when they decided to build the addition onto the house, the stone addition with servants' quarters upstairs and the kitchen downstairs.
Okay.
That was fine. And then this home went through a succession of owners over the decades. And the house went under a lot of revisions. Became a commercial property. This it was Market Street out front when the house was first built, just a little rural dirt lane. It became Main Street, and eventually the International Road, Route 40, passed right in front of the house here. So the house became a commercial property on Main Street. Most of the time it had living quarters upstairs, but the downstairs was converted into such businesses as a dry goods store, a grocery store, a hardware store. There was a bakery in here at one time. At one time was occupied by an undertaker / woodworker or furniture maker, which was probably when most of the fine woods in the building were stripped out of the place.
Mm-hmm.
House became vacant in 1946. The last private owner of the house bought it, and with plans to convert it into a bed and breakfast. They had bed and breakfast back then. Who knew? But he got into it, did some work on it, and realized it was way too much.
Big project.
And he left it. He abandoned it. And it was vacant and deteriorating badly for a number of years.
So who finally said, let's save this treasure?
The Stewart family, owners of the Observer Reporter, absolutely the Observer at that time, the local newspaper. It was about to be torn down by the city of Washington to make way for a parking lot, the classic. Okay, tear it down and make a parking lot out of it. The Stewarts raised a campaign through their newspaper, managed to get the state interested into it. The state bought the property in 1959.
And the actual total refurbishing took how long?
They bought the house in 1959, and it opened as a house museum in 1965. So we're talking 6 years. And they did a tremendously good job. Every time I walk through this house, I'm impressed with how well it looks and how much it would have looked like when David was here. We like to think that David could walk through that door right now and look at this place and feel at home.
Say,
considering
I'm
the furnishings and everything. Right.
Yeah.
He could do that.
So I know you operate as a nonprofit. And how do you keep up the house? What type of funding do you get to keep up the house?
Well, they're private donations. We seek every day.
Yes.
We have proceeds from our tours here. And we have a director who does a great job at finding his grants.
Tracy does a good job.
Tracy has done an excellent job.
Yes.
Still, it's a struggle, like every small museum.
A labor of love.
It is. It has to be. You have to really be into this.
Yes, you do.
Stick around.
Well, I'm glad you are. No. And thanks again.
Sure.
Lainey, you work here at the Bradford House as a docent, telling people all about the history of the house. So we're here in the sewing room, and my goodness, it's just filled with so many wonderful things. A spinning wheel, and what is this contraption here?
A loom.
A loom, and lots of interesting period attire.
Yes.
So tell me about what you're holding here, and this fabric you made on the loom?
Yes, this is linen, and people, the pioneers that would come out here, they are going to spend about 18 months to make a shirt. So you will plant this flax and come back out a year later and make it into thread. That's
so
the linen
this
right
starts,
here.
This is linen right here.
And it starts with flax.
Okay, this is flax here.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, so from this, it turns into this. So I'm sure that when you have demonstrations, people explain how the this plant turns into fabric.
Yes.
Amazing hard work of our ancestors, wasn't it?
Yes, very much.
Yes. Okay, and then what are you holding out there?
This is a linsey woolsey, because the other thing we will make fabric out at this time is wool. And Washington County will become the Merino sheep capital of the world. They say they traded their whiskey in for wool.
Wow. And when did that occur, when it became the sheep cap, Merino sheep capital?
After 1800.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. So tell me also about, do you do the spinning on the spinning wheel?
It is done, but not by me. yes, we have a weaver. Her name is Kathleen Wells, and this is her loom. And so she does make the fabric for us.
Oh, that's wonderful. So the furniture in the house, is it original to the house, Lainey?
No, it is not. David and his family would have taken their pieces with them, but they are all authentic 18th century pieces, and they have been hand-picked by some wonderful people for this Bradford House.
We are in this charming room, which looks like a children's room or nursery. And once again, I'm taken by the beautiful deep color peach on the fireplace. And tell me about the family that would have lived here and some of the pieces in the room.
I certainly will. Well, Dave and Elizabeth Bradford will eventually end up with 9 children, but we believe there were 4 born here. And there would have been 2 in each bed. The children would have been tutored in here and probably eaten dinner in here. They were not to be with the family until they were old enough to sit well. And we like to show you the little children are dressed like big people, so they get your cut downs. These are rope beds.
Rope beds.
So the good night, sleep tight, don't let the bed bugs bite.
That's where that expression comes mm-hmm. from. Good night, sleep tight. Mm-hmm. Don't let the bed bugs bite. So at night, would you tighten the ropes before you got in bed so it wouldn't sag?
Yes, we have a rope key over there. And quite different at the time. They would use straight pins. The ladies use straight pins, but they're also going to be on the baby's diapers.
I see.
So not too fun for the baby.
No, not if they're wiggling.
And the doll furniture that is in this house belonged to the Harding family that lived here for many years. Mm-hmm. And it was prototypes the furniture maker could make for you. And then this bed is made so you could lace a toddler in and they wouldn't be able to get out.
Very clever, very clever.
And this room is 99.9% original. Oh. It is the most original room in the house.
Wow, it's lovely. Well, now we're in the master bedroom of David Bradford and his wife, and it's quite a bright room, isn't it? Lots of natural light coming in here. And the bed, what size bed would you say it is?
Well, it does look short.
Yes.
But they slept sitting up, so...
They slept sitting up.
They did.
Why would they do that?
Well, they're going to keep themselves warm by the fire, and also their cooking is open hearth cooking, so mm-hmm. they did have a lot of lung congestion, and they say it wasn't very comfortable for them to lie down.
I see. So anything else in this room that is particularly, this desk is very impressive.
That is a lady's desk, and unlike the man's desk downstairs, there are no secret hiding places because mm-hmm. the ladies were not allowed to keep secrets.
The bathroom is outside, correct?
Mostly, yes, but that is a master bathroom.
That's a master bathroom over there.
Your master bathroom.
And that's a wash stand?
Yes, a man shaving stand and uh-huh. a chamber pot, so and a mirror. So I tell the kids that's the master bath.
How about that? What is this building back here?
This is the cookhouse, a replica of the cookhouse that was here when the Bradfords lived here. The original burned down, another one burned down after that. So that wasn't here whenever the house was developed or restored and brought back. But several years ago, we decided we should have a cookhouse.
So we're here now, Dave, in this charming kitchen house, which is separate from the main house and was built as a replica of what you think was here.
Correct.
Okay.
It was built several years ago, about the time we converted the kitchen into a tavern, the inside tavern.
Yes.
Most houses at the time would have had a separate kitchen, sometimes called a summer kitchen.
And that was for safety reasons.
That was for safety reasons. They kept burning. Two of them burned here that we know of on the Bradford property. And it was fairly common to have the kitchen burn up. So they were not attached to the house. They were a place of, I've often told people when they came here, look at this thing, this is very charming.
It is.
But it was a hell of a place to work.
I bet it was hot.
To be honest with you. It would have been hot. This would have been used during the summer for the most part. This was David's summer home. Mm-hmm. So it would be hot to begin with. The eaves are built open, so allow smoke and heat to come out. It would have had a loft up on top of it where the kitchen maids would have slept. Cooking was open hearth cooking. Basically, that's what they did. They cooked outside the fireplace on the hearth,
sure.
which would add more to the smoke and heat coming into the place here.
So we're outside the David Bradford House, and it certainly is a sturdy-looking home, Dave.
It's a very sturdy home. Up above us is the second-floor bedroom windows to David's and Elizabeth's bedroom.
Yes.
Legend has it that David actually jumped out that window onto a waiting horse below to escape federal troops knocking at his door.
How swashbuckling.
It never happened.
It never happened.
It would have either killed him or the horse, that jump anyhow, to begin with.
And folklore.
It's historic folklore. It's been carried by the family for quite a while. Mm-hmm. Several researchers have looked into it and decided that David left long before the federal troops came and knocked on his door.
So Dave, mm-hmm. you brought me now to the tavern.
We are in the tavern.
The sign of the Seven Stars Tavern.
The Seven Stars represent the seven counties that were involved in the Whiskey Rebellion. Five in Pennsylvania. At this time, part of this area was still Virginia. So when you count all the counties that were involved in the thing, there were seven counties.
Gotcha. So the taverns at the time, that was a gathering place where the people would come together, talk about the issues of the day and the time, and I'm sure that this is kind of the type of place where all the talk about the upset of the whiskey tax started.
Exactly. Same way during our own American Revolutionary War. It was the taverns that were the gathering place, particularly in the frontier end of the country. Every little hamlet didn't have a school, didn't have a church, didn't have any place to gather, but they all had a tavern, at least one. There were two in Washington at the time.
Always a tavern.
Always a tavern.
Right. And so what were they serving here to drink in the tavern?
Mostly whiskey. If they were entrepreneur types, they would stretch their resources to obtain brandy from over the mountains. But it was mostly different types of whiskey that would be we served here.
And so locally, the people were farmers, and so they would make the whiskey with their leftover barley rye, and so this was their drink of choice.
This was their drink of choice. Everybody, even, it was like wine in France. Everybody drank whiskey here. Even children, it was considered healthy for them to have dollops of whiskey every now and then. Yeah. So there was no, it was a drink of choice. And it was also their cash crop, their only cash crop.
Yes.
And that's why they were so angry about this whiskey tax.
So who comes along to put this tax on the whiskey but none other than?
Our good friend Alexander Hamilton, who was the Secretary of the Treasury at the time.
And under the president of George Washington.
George Washington. He was able to convince George and Congress that this was the best way to raise some money quickly to pay off about $80 million in debt. Left over from the Revolutionary War, and he called it a luxury tax at the time. Fine, that worked east of the mountains, but not here in very pioneer territory. It was mostly consisting of subsistence farmers in this area.
Yes.
And anything they had left over, they would convert their grains into whiskey and sell it, and it was the only way they could make any hard cash at all.
So along come the tax collectors.
Correct.
To try and get the money from the farmers. And what happens?
Well, it was called an excise tax back then. Because these would be excise agents, excise collectors, tax collectors in a general term. They were captured, roughed up, horses taken from them, and in some cases tarred and feathered, which is a horrible way to be treated. Tied to trees in the middle of the night and left all night long after their heads were shaved and all their clothes and everything were taken from them. There was quick resistance to the tax here in western Pennsylvania.
So this gets back to President Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And how does he decide to deal with the protesters here in western PA?
He raises an army of 13,000 troops. To come this way. This is the first time a president has led an army or a force against his own people in America.
Yes.
There were a lot of firsts that happened during the Whiskey Rebellion here, and this was probably the most important one. George Washington led that army as far as Bedford before he determined that the Whiskey Rebellion itself had died out. Turned around, took most of the army back to Philadelphia, sent a small force ahead to arrest all the ringleaders of the rebellion.
And what happened? And one of the ringleaders, I take it, was other than our boy David Bradford.
Correct. He was he turned in to be quite the rabid anti-federalist tax person here in Washington. Some people feel he was sort of coerced into leading this thing, being one of the leaders. But others feel that he was in league with the rebels all the time. He managed to engineer a robbing of the mail, for instance, between Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, just in order to find out who was saying nasty things about them to the federal government in Philadelphia at this time. But definitely he was involved in leading the Whiskey Rebellion.
I see. So then he fled his home.
He fled.
And to avoid being arrested.
He felt certain that he was going to be hung. He did not think he was going to get a pardon. He did not want to sign the amnesty provision that the federal government was putting out for people to sign in southwestern Pennsylvania. And because he failed to do that, and because he robbed the mail, he didn't think he was going to get away with it.
A couple pretty serious offenses, I would say.
So he took off, and several days before, the federal troops, led by Alexander Hamilton, by the way, he came this way to make sure things were done right, actually knocked on the very door that we have at the Bradford House now. Mm-hmm. The restorers found that door in the basement.
The original door of the home.
They rebuilt it and hung it here. And David had already fled all the way, even though he's pursued, he fled all the way to Spanish West Florida, which at that point is the sort of like the extended panhandle of the Florida we know today. Okay. It reached all the way into Louisiana Territory. It was under Spanish control at that time. He basically fled to another country.
Mm. And did his family ever join him?
They did. A little under 2 years later, mm-hmm. the family moved to join him. But Elizabeth, his wife, wanted to make sure he had built a decent home for her down there before he decided to move all the way there. Plus, she was helping to liquidate all the vast properties that David had in this territory.
And whatever happened, did he ever get pardoned, or did he ever just go into oblivion?
No, he did not. He built himself quite a life in Louisiana. Actually, he built a plantation near Baton Rouge in a place called St. Francisville off of a bayou. And he built quite a plantation, raised tobacco and cotton, and was very involved in civic affairs in Baton Rouge and New Orleans. And the plantation still exists, by the way. It's called the Myrtles.
The Myrtles.
And you can look it up online. There's a bed and breakfast there, with part of the bed and breakfast building being a house that David built whenever he fled to Louisiana.
That would be an awesome place to go visit after you come here. Go stay at the Myrtles.
You would?
Yes.
It's also billed as the most haunted house in America, so you have to be careful with that,
okay.
I guess.
All right.
And he died of yellow fever at the age of 55. So he did not live. He didn't even enjoy Louisiana that much, but he did an awful lot. He seemed to be able to do an awful lot in a very little time. He raised 9 children. When he was here, he held several local offices. Mm-hmm. He was one of the people who started the first church in Washington. He was very civic-minded and very involved.
I can see your pride in talking about him here in his home, and he obviously was an important founding father of Washington, PA.
Washington, PA, he was.
Yes. So how did the, just tell our viewers the resolution then of the Whiskey Rebellion and how it all finished out.
Yeah, in a nutshell, George Washington was very magnanimous. He pulled this army together, which is quite a feat in itself, 13,000 troops, militia troops. Each state had to contribute its share of troops, built this army very quickly and moved it this way. Which shows great leadership on the part of our founding father there.
Yes.
And the rebellion quickly dissolved. Decided, okay, it's time to hang up our guns and go home.
Yeah.
And George Washington pardoned everybody involved with the rebellion except for David.
Ah.
About 20 people were arrested on something called a Terrible Night. And taken back over the mountains to stand trial in federal court in Philadelphia. Of the 20, only 2 were convicted. David was tried in absentia and convicted. Various and sundry other people faced charges back home here of lesser type, but George Washington issued a blanket pardon for anybody involved in the Whiskey Rebellion except for David. David wasn't pardoned until John Adams was president.
Well, finally, John Adams took pity on him.
Well, you want to get to the final denouement here? Yes.
Yes.
John Adams was pardoned, David.
I want to thank you all for joining me today on my adventure looking back in time at the historic David Bradford House in Washington, PA. And remember, I hope that you'll get excited about our journey here, seeing the house, but it's so much better in person. Please come and visit it and meet the docents yourself. They are just so wonderful. I stand here and I have my hand on the handrail of the mahogany staircase that David Bradford touched himself. and I am just amazed at all the wonderful history located in our backyards. Till I see you again, have happy journeys.